For this particular module, we decided to focus our attention on homosexuality as a crime in Victorian England and the punishments and trials that followed. Today we'll discuss such a story of three popular figures and their struggle with the dogma built around homosexuality throughout the 19th and 20th century, and how their battle with it intertwined with the circumstances affected their legacy. Oscar Wilde, full name Oscar Fingal O'Flaherty Wills Wilde, was born on the 16th of October, 1854, in Westland Row, Dublin, Ireland. His father, Sir William Wilde, was a famous ear and eye specialist, and mother Jane Wilde, a revolutionary poet. Wilde, along with his four other siblings, was raised with a special heed being paid to their academics. Starting at an early age, and up until age 9, Oscar Wilde was homeschooled, surrounded by diverse and multilingual househelp. Since his childhood, Wilde learnt German and French before he began even college. Life in London. Having moved to London in the late 19th century to pursue a city life, Wilde found himself fitting in the busy lifestyle perfectly, and had acquainted himself with places and establishments that not only became part of his routine, but today, more than a century later, have become an integral part of his story. Here are some of those places mentioned.
Located on 68th Regent Street in Piccadilly, Hotel Cafe Royal was first built in 1865. Rising to fame by the 1890s, Hotel Cafe Royal was also the place where Oscar Wilde and Alfred Douglas met. Royal Haymarket Theatre. As one of the oldest standing playhouses in London, Royal Haymarket Theatre has seen the presence of legendary actors and directors create art on stage. Built in 1720, Royal Haymarket Theatre has been standing for more than three centuries.
Oscar Wilde found his poetry to be at its peak by the 1890s, becoming a widely known poet and playwright in Victorian England with works that included The Importance of Being Earnest and The Picture of Dorian Gray. But with this fame also increased his perceived notoriety, and sneering to the critics who claimed Oscar Wilde's work were vulgar. Fame, a two-edged sword? The same popularity that kept Wilde at the center of their attention also proved dangerous when it considered his private life. Wilde's homosexuality was brought to light when he started an affair with another British poet, Alfred Douglas. Douglas's father, who was against the relationship, left a calling card for Wilde, stating that Wilde is a sodomite, leading to Wilde's filing of a libel case against Douglas.
The Old Bailey is London's central criminal court. The building is also known as Justice Hall or the Sessions House. This central court is located in the western part of the City of London. This building, like many others in Britain, has its own history of periodically rebuilding and remodeling in response to, and of course influenced by, the ways that trials were carried out. It was in this court that Oscar Wilde brought the libel case against the Marquess of Queensberry on April the 3rd, 1895. The trial didn't go in favour of Oscar Wilde. There was one main problem. Queensberry's allegations about Oscar Wilde's homosexuality were true, so the court couldn't consider the allegations as defamatory, and he was found guilty. 16th century marks the era when lawmakers in Britain decided to categorize homosexuality as a criminal act. During the reign of King Henry VIII, the Parliament in England passed the Buggery Act 1533. This was the first time in Britain's history that sex between men became a crime punishable by death. It took more than 300 years until the Offences Against the Person Act 1861 was introduced and passed by Parliament. This act abolished the death penalty for the acts of sodomy and instead offered a minimum of 10 years imprisonment. James Pratt and John Smith were the last two men hanged in England for gay sex. However, in 1885, the Criminal Law Amendment Act once again made any male homosexual act illegal, whether or not a witness was present, meaning that even acts committed in private could be prosecuted. Often a letter expressing terms of affection between two men was all that was required to bring a prosecution. The legislation was so ambiguously worded that it became known as the Blackmailer's Charter, and in 1895, Oscar Wilde fell victim and was sent to prison for gross indecency after being convicted of sodomy. The judge remarked at his sentencing, "It is the worst case I have ever tried. I shall pass the severest sentence that the law allows. In my judgment, it is totally inadequate for such a case as this. The sentence of the court is that you be imprisoned and kept to hard labor for 2 years." They have sent him immediately to Newgate Prison for processing, and later to Pentonville Prison in Caledonian Road in North London, where he spent a few months picking oakum, a substance which was used to seal gaps in shipbuilding. At the time, it was a common practice to get prisoners to untwist and to tease apart recycled ropes in order to have the fibers required in making oakum. He also had one more stop at Wandsworth Prison before he was transferred to London's Reading Jail. It is reported that during the time that he spent at Wandsworth Prison, he collapsed from hunger and his right eardrum was ruptured. Oscar Wilde was released from Reading Jail on May 18, 1897, and he took himself to France without ever returning to Britain or Ireland. In his new but short life in France, he changed his name to Sebastian Melmoth. In 1900, Wilde was battling with an illness, which physicians later stated was from an infection caused by his ruptured eardrum. Later, his condition became worse, and finally, he was diagnosed as having developed meningitis. Oscar died a few days later. He was buried in Père Lachaise Cemetery in Paris.
A British mathematician and thinker, Alan Turing was born on the 23rd of June, 1912. Turing's capabilities, though, didn't just limit themselves to that. Apart from mathematics, Turing was also a biologist and a computer scientist.
Alan Turing's contribution to the society doesn't just stop at his mathematical skills, or his ability as a thinker. Alan Turing's works and thesis further also helped in the field of artificial intelligence and computer science. Academics aside, Turing's also proved of great help to the Allies during World War II, helping decipher messages and radio signals. Further, Alan Turing and his team designed a code-breaking machine called the Bomb to aid the British intelligence during the war.
In 1941, Turing proposed marriage to John Clark, a fellow mathematician, but their engagement was short-lived. After admitting his homosexuality to his fiancée, who was reportedly unfazed by the revelation, Turing decided that he could not go through with the marriage. John Clark's interview with BBC Horizon program from 1992 is one of the only instances in which she spoke about her time as a cryptoanalyst.
I suppose the fact that I was a woman made me different. We did do some things together, perhaps went to the cinema and so on, but certainly it was a surprise to me when he said, I think his words probably were, would you consider marrying me? But although it was a surprise, I really didn't hesitate in saying yes. And then he knelt by my chair and kissed me. Though we didn't have very much physical contact. Now, next day, I suppose we went a bit of a walk together after lunch. He told me that he had this homosexual tendency. And naturally, that worried me a bit because I did know that that was something which was almost certainly permanent, but we carried on.
In 1952, Turing went to the police to report the robbery by a friend called Arnold Murray, who he hosted in his house. Alan met Arnold, a 19-year-old unemployed man, while walking the streets of Manchester. From the robbery complaint, the British authorities came to the conclusion that Turing usually entertained homosexual relations and arrested him. Alan Turing and Arnold Murray were prosecuted for a long list of offences contrary to the Sexual Offences Act 1885. Their relationship had been categorised as a list of gross indecencies, which was obviously a crime taken seriously. Arnold Murray was remanded in custody, and Alan Turing had to decide how best to deal with his legal situation. A trial would inevitably take this unassuming, brilliant man who worked for government communications headquarters and had security clearance from the British government into the public limelight. The details of his private life would be exposed to the world, and he decided the best thing to do was to avoid a trial and accept his guilt. Gross indecency was still an offence that many men were sent to prison for. The threat of a custodial sentence on a professional man was significant, but the courts in the 1950s did consider other options too. The majority of those convicted for such offences were sentenced to probation orders. In Alan Turing's case, it was an order which also incorporated a medical recommendation that he was suitable for estrogen injection, the purposes of which were to suppress his sexual urges, what has been termed a chemical castration. Grotesque as it seems now, in the 1950s, this was seen as a viable method of rehabilitation. The convictions that Alan Turing was charged for was the beginning of the end of his life. His security clearance for government communication headquarters was removed because of fear he was susceptible to blackmail by the USSR. The estrogen had taken a physical toll and changed his body. On June 7, 1954, Alan Turing was found dead, poisoned by cyanide of potassium, and the coroner ruled he'd committed suicide.
Case of John Gielgud. Sir John Gielgud was a legendary actor of both theater and screen. Winner of an Academy Award and a Golden Globe, Gielgud got knighted in the year 1953. Film experts Brian McFarlane was quoted saying about him in terms of performing arts, it's no exaggeration to say that he's towered over the century, with an Emmy, a Grammy, an Oscar, and a Tony for the 1948 production of Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest. Gielgud became one of the very few people to achieve this.
1953 was the year of Gielgud's gay scandal. Sir John Gielgud, the newly knighted actor, was at the height of his career, but on 21st of October 1953, an undercover police arrested him in a public lavatory. Gielgud was charged with persistently importuning men for immoral purposes. When the actor appeared in the dock, the name on the charge sheet was John Smith, but the journalist recognised the actor, who pleaded guilty and was fined £10. His career was threatened to be ruined, as his conviction caused a sensation. He was vilified by the media. His visa for the United States was refused. He received some hate mails, and a petition was launched demanding his resignation from Equity, the actors' union. However, the actor enjoyed the support of the public until the end of his life.
Although the scandal surrounding his arrest didn't lead to the lengthy trial or punishment, Gielgud still found himself struggling with the nuisance caused. From homophobic remarks that were made against him, to the social dogma around homosexuality in his time and age, Gielgud was later stated saying he contemplated suicide before turning up to his rehearsals the next day due to the embarrassment caused to him by the front page news cover of the incident.
Sir John Gielgud died on 21st of May 2000 at the age of 96. He once said to Sir Ian McKellen that when I die, all they say about me is that I was the first queer actor to be knighted.
We are such stuff as dreams are made of, and our little life is rounded with a sleep.
Since the Buggery Act passed in 1533, many men have been convicted and executed for the crime of homosexuality, but many critics suggest that the high-profile cases such as Oscar Wilde, Alan Turing, and Sir John Gielgud helped the legalization of homosexuality in Britain in 1967. In 1967, the Sexual Offences Act was passed, which decriminalized private homosexual acts between men aged over 21, while at the same time imposing heavier penalties on street offences. The law was not changed for Scotland until 1980 and for Northern Ireland until 1982.